Psalm 96. The whole thing. Sing God a brand new song. Earth and everyone in it, sing. Sing to God, worship God, shout the news of his victory from sea to sea. Take the news of his glory to the lost. News of his wonders to one and all, for God is great and worthy of 1,000 hallelujahs. His furious beauty puts the other gods to shame. Pagan gods are mere tatters and rags. God made the heavens. Royal splendor radiates from him. A powerful beauty sets them apart. Bravo, God! Bravo! Everyone join in the great shout. Encore, in awe before the beauty, in awe before the might. Bring gifts and celebrate. Bow before the beauty of God, then to your knees. Everyone worship. Get out the message. God rules. He put the world on a firm foundation. He treats everyone fair and square. Let's hear it from the sky, with earth joining in, and a huge round of applause from the sea. Let wilderness turn cartwheels. Animals, come, dance. Put every tree of the forest in the choir, an extravaganza before God as he comes to set everything right on earth, set everything right, treat everyone fair. It's a bit of a ripper, isn't it? I think it's probably the message, John, required that, so you'll talk about that a bit later. And our gospel today is from John 4. Jesus realized that the Pharisees were keeping count of the baptisms that he and John performed, although his disciples, not Jesus, did the actual baptizing. They had posted the score that Jesus was ahead, turning him and John into rivals in the eyes of the people. So Jesus left the Judean countryside and went back to Galilee. And to get there, he had to pass through Samaria. So we came to Sychar, a Samaritan village that bordered the field Jacob had given his son Joseph. Jacob's well was still there. Jesus, worn out by the trip, sat down at the well. It was noon. A woman, a Samaritan, came to draw water. Jesus said, "Would you give me a drink of water?" His disciples had gone to the village to buy food for lunch. The Samaritan woman, taken aback, asked, "How come you, a Jew, is asking me, a Samaritan woman, for a drink?" Jews in those days wouldn't be caught dead talking to Samaritans. Jesus answered, "If you knew the generosity of God and who I am, you would be asking me for a drink, and I would be giving you fresh, living water." The woman said, "Sir, you don't even have a bucket to draw with, and this well is deep. So how are you going to get this living water? Are you a better man than our ancestor Jacob, who dug this well and drank from it, he and his sons and livestock, and passed it down to us?" Jesus said, "Everyone who drinks this water will get thirsty again and again. Anyone who drinks the water I will give will never thirst, not ever. The water I give will be artesian spring within, gushing fountains of endless life." The woman said, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't ever get thirsty, won't ever have to come back to this well again." And he said, "Go call your husband and then come back." "I have no husband," she said. "That's nicely put. I have no husband. You've had five husbands, and the man you're living with now isn't even your husband." "You spoke the truth there, sure enough." "Oh, so you're a prophet. Well, tell me this. Our ancestors worship God at this mountain, but you Jews insist that Jerusalem is the only place for worship, right?" Jesus said, "Believe me, woman, the time's coming when you will not have to be in Jerusalem or on this mountain to worship the Father. When what you've called will not matter, and where you go to worship will not matter. The time is coming. In fact, the time is now here when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. These are the kind of people the Father wants to be as worshippers. God is spirit, so people who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. And the woman said, I don't know about that. I do know that the Messiah is coming, though. When he arrives, we'll get the whole story. And Jesus said, he's talking to you now. I am the Messiah.
Regeneration and growth. My topic was engaging worship, but there was also a second topic attached to it called becoming a welcoming and inviting church, and sewing those two thoughts together has been a rather interesting exercise. Back to Psalm 96 that Tim read. Sing, God, a brand new song. Earth and everyone in it, sing. Sing to God. Worship God. Shout the news of his victory from sea to sea. Take the news of his glory to the lost. News of his wonders to one and all. Well, that's good stuff. But when it says, sing to God, worship God, I stop and think, worship God. What does that mean? Worship God. What does it connote to you? What does it say to you? The word worship. Just one word, what does worship mean? Sorry? Singing? Prayer? Sorry?
Humble yourself.
Humbling yourself? Praise? Honor?
Adoration?
Connection? So that word worship has a plethora of meanings, hasn't it? Or understandings, interpretations. The Bible says, let's go into his dwelling place. Let's worship at his holy hill. Exalt the Lord our God. Worship at his holy hill. Worship at his footstool. Bring an offering. Come into his courts. So worship is something we do here on Sunday mornings. The Bible says worship is about acts of the mouth, things we say, we sing, acts of praise, acts of repentance, all of those things that we do in our service, sure. But is worship just about liturgies and organs and drums and keyboards and guitars? Or is it even a church service? Is worship even a church service? See, I want to suggest this morning that these aspects that we've spoken about, that I've mentioned, you've mentioned, are externals. Some that you mentioned weren't, but some were. They help us to worship. They help us enter into God's presence, but they're not of themselves true worship. Because true worship, in essence, is something that's internal. It's a matter of the heart. Jesus' words about worship to this unnamed Samaritan woman that Tim read about occur in the context of his witness to bring this woman to saving faith. Think about it. That was the context. Now, we might not think of witnessing as the right context to talk about the priority of worship. But Jesus takes her implicit question there about whether Samaritan worship or Jewish worship is correct. And then he uses that to zero in on the aim of the gospel, which is to turn sinners into true worshippers of God. It's the aim of the gospel, to turn sinners into true worshippers of God. You see, in the old way of worship back in the day, like Deuteronomy days, place was significant. Place was important. One example, the Jewish males, for example, had to go up three times a year for the feasts in Jerusalem. But in this new way that Jesus inaugurates, he is the new temple. Where we gather to worship is secondary. How and whom we worship is primary. many people like this Samaritan woman mistakenly think today that if they go through those proper externals of worship, you know, going to a church building, going through the weekly rituals, everything's going to be fine between them and God. But they're not dealing with the heart of worship. They're not dealing with God on a heart level. You can go to as many church services as you like. You can do as many good deeds as you wish, but never be truly worshipping, because all of that stuff's external. If nothing's happening in our heart toward God, it's external. There's a song that we sometimes sing here. It's getting on a bit now, about 25 or 30 years old maybe, called The Heart of Worship by Matt Redman. And he writes that this song was born from a period of apathy within his home church in Watford in England. The congregation, you see, was struggling to find meaning despite the fact that there was a worship revival spreading around the UK and people were writing brilliant songs of praise and worship. But he said there was a dynamic missing in their church. And so the pastor did a pretty brave thing. He decided to get rid of the sound system, get rid of the keyboard, get rid of the band, and we gathered together with just our voices. His point was that we'd lost our way in worship. And the way to get back to the heart would be to strip everything off. Reminding his church family to be producers of worship, not just consumers, the pastor said, "When you come through the doors on a Sunday, what are you bringing as your offering to God?" Redman says the question initially led to some embarrassing silence. "Aren't you glad it was a rhetorical statement I was making? You didn't have to answer." So there was embarrassing silence there, but eventually the people broke into a cappella singing and heartfelt prayers, encountering God in a fresh way. Before long, he says, we reintroduced the musicians and the organ and the band, the sound system, because we'd gained a new perspective that worship is really all about Jesus. And he commands a response in the depths of our souls, no matter the circumstances or setting. Redman remembers writing this song quickly in his bedroom soon after the church's journey together. The words simply expressing his own personal subjective response to what he was learning about worship. He says, "My song, The Heart of Worship, simply described what occurred." Amazed by how God has since taken this song around the world for his purposes, Redman says, in regard to his own lack of foresight, "This song nearly didn't go any further than my bedroom." Because you see, he showed it to the pastor and the pastor loved it and they played it in church, and next thing it's all around the world helping people to understand what true worship is. We're going to spend a few minutes now, it's 5 minutes, just in silence listening to this song. The lyrics will be on the screen also. But just see how the Holy Spirit ushers us into a new understanding of what true worship of God can be and what it really is. Understanding that worship, true worship, worship in spirit and truth is all about Jesus. Where does that take us? What do we do now? Well, I want to suggest that our inner responses to God when we worship that way reflect his infinite worth and beauty. That's what worship was designed to do. Put the supreme worth of God on display. Why? Well, so that when we know him truly, when we treasure him daily and duly, that inner valuing becomes visible to the whole world. How? Well, in Hebrews it says, let's go outside then, where Jesus is, where the action is, not trying to be privileged insiders. This insider world is not our home. Let's take our place outside with Jesus. No longer pouring out the sacrificial blood of animals, but pouring out sacrificial praises from our lips to God in Jesus' name. And make sure you don't take things for granted and go slack in working for the common good. Share what you have with others. God takes particular pleasure in acts of worship, but a different kind of sacrifice. The type that takes place in the kitchen and the workplace and on the streets. Hebrews 13. And Paul says in Romans, here's what I want you to do, God helping you. Take your everyday, your ordinary life, your sleeping, eating, going to work, and walking around life, and place it before God as an offering, so that all of your life, done in love for others and in reliance upon God, displays the worth of God above all things and makes us worshippers in our daily life. Embracing what God does for you is the best thing you can do for Him. So don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. How do we go about our day remembering God regularly? Well, I guess if you're a bit like me, overly hyper-focused, it might not be easy. So those of you that have been in meetings with me will know or remember that I have a monastic bell that I have set to ring every 30 minutes, like that, to bring me back to God. Just dings every 30 minutes and I can take myself where I want to go depending on what's happening, but I'm remembering God again. And so it helps draw me back into His presence. You might want to do something like that. You may not have such a flitty mind as I've got. The inner essence of worship is to know God truly and then respond from the heart by valuing Him, treasuring Him, praising Him, enjoying Him, being satisfied with Him above everything else. And then watch that deep, joyful satisfaction in God overflow in acts of praise from your lips, from your actions, acts of love, serving others. And serving also incorporates sharing our faith, our knowledge of Jesus. The scriptures are filled with encouragement to worship in everything and to live a life of worship. For example, my mouth's filled with your praise, the psalmist says, declaring your splendor all day long. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. And a special verse from Corinthians, whether you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Do they suggest to you that our whole lives can be a symphony of praise and worship? Well, how? We're called to be the fragrance of Christ. 2 Corinthians 2 says, now thanks be to God who always leads us in triumph in Christ and through us, wait for it, diffuses the fragrance of His knowledge in every place. Wow, isn't that powerful? Isn't that beautiful? God, through Christ, and then through us, diffuses the fragrance of His knowledge in every place, for we are to God the fragrance of Christ. We're the aroma, the fragrance of Jesus Christ among people we meet every day. Could that mean that when we engage with others anywhere, everywhere, they could sense the aroma of Christ about us? Or feel it through hearing our words? Sometimes we think our contribution in the church is insignificant, but I want to say it's not. We all have that special privilege of being fragrance as we fulfill our roles, whether they're big or small, our ministries here in the church, as we welcome people, as we engage with them, as we show interest, care, prepare refreshments, participate, help them connect with one another and with God. I just want to take the welcomer's role, for example. How vital it is, a ministry of fragrance. It's just more than handing out pew sheets. It's about letting the aroma of Christ permeate your ministry, showing visitors to a pew, introducing them to someone there, making sure they're not left alone, inviting them to morning tea, taking them there, helping them connect with others and with God. A pastor called Andrew Stuart Darling wrote, "Research indicates that most visitors to church will have made up their minds in the first 2 minutes whether they'll come again or not." Well, he suggests that although this might be discouraging for the pastor who hopes visitors will come back because of the sermon or because the musicians are on holy fire, actually it's probably the small, almost missed things that will decide whether or not visitors come back. He says, think of the hotel doorman theory. There's a value having someone stand at the front door of a hotel, even when that door opens automatically. It's the smile, the reassurance, the knowledge of taxis or parking, or the umbrella, the small comment that will make a guest's stay that much more memorable. These are the small intangible things that are so hard to put a value on, but worth everything when visiting a church for the first time. That's because we are created to be social animals, and it's those small human moments of connection that keep us coming back. He concludes, it takes a lot of guts to turn up to a church when you don't know what you believe, you don't know anyone there, and everyone else there seems to know everyone else. So if I can help bring a smile and ease the tension a little at the door, I reckon the sermon's already begun. John Wimber, the founder of the Vineyard Church, he used to say, people come to church for many reasons, but they stay for only one, relationship. I think you all know Christine McKee, our librarian and helper at Mainly Music. She's not here today, or I would have picked on her. Do you know how she came to be here? She visited here one Sunday just to check out the church. And she might not have returned, she tells me, but for the fact that a wonderful welcomer was very welcoming, very interested in her, very caring, took her to a pew, introduced her to a parishioner in the pew, and then looked out for her every Sunday for the next 3 months. It's powerful, isn't it? She came to Christ then. The first 2 minutes, super important. So, just to conclude, the challenge is to think about committing oneself, yourself, myself, ourselves, to a lifestyle of worship from the heart, and watch the effect of Christ's aroma, whether on the door or making morning tea or preaching or playing. Watch Christ's perfume, his fragrance, permeate every situation we encounter. And I'm not just thinking of here, I'm thinking more out there, where Christ can be on display through our worshipful attitude. If we can get into the groove of living in the state of worship 24/7, anywhere, everywhere, the fragrance of Christ himself will permeate every encounter. Think about it. So that when you do come to church, you won't simply coming to meet God, you'll be bringing God with you. And when you go out and meet others, you'll be taking God with you. Diffusing, what's the scripture say? Diffusing the fragrance of his knowledge everywhere you go. Beautiful, isn't it? Inspiring, encouraging. Just a couple of minutes, because time's most likely gone. I'm not looking at coffee. We are the fragrance of Christ. We roll it on, thanks. Alex? Three T's. I recall doing this once before, or more than once before here when we were interim priests here. The three T's. This time tomorrow. Okay? So here we go. Next slide. Here we go. I just want us briefly to share what we'll be doing this time tomorrow. Okay? Could be you're still in bed. That's all right. Whatever you're doing this time tomorrow, where you'll be, what you'll be doing, and who you'll be with. So maybe you could just call out, what will you be doing at this time tomorrow? Planning a birthday party. With whom? On your own?
My son and his son. Son and grandson.
So you'll all be working together, planning a part. Wonderful. That sounds exciting.
At the theatre.
At the theatre? At the where?
Dentist.
Oh, at the dentist. Wow.
Children's emergency care
with nurses and kids.
Yes. Yes. Fellowship group in our village.
Fellowship group in the village, right?
Walking.
Walking out on your own?
Yes.
Right.
Preparing to teach.
Sorry?
Preparing to teach.
Preparing to teach at school?
Yep.
So there'll be others
yep.
round about? Okay, so that's a huge preparation project.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, a whole lot of different things. Anything else?
I'll be doing housework.
Housework on your own? It's all right too.
Receiving acupuncture.
Receiving acupuncture. Right. Ooh. Okay, so we've got a lot of things here. Next thing here. We've listened carefully to each other. Next thing. We're just going to pause for a moment or two because there's such a range of different things we'll be doing tomorrow, and we could just be trucking along doing them, you know, just normally. I've done it before, I'm doing it again, and I'll be doing it next week as well. Or we could be thinking, how can I be so engaged in the presence of God, worship, that worshipful attitude, that Christ will diffuse his love and presence through me in that scenario. Now, it might be difficult for some of you to think how, but we'll just stop. And we'll just pause, think about ourselves, think about the other people's activities we've heard about. Some are going to be on their own, and that's okay to worship that way. But some of us are going to be engaging with other people. And so we want God to create an opportunity for other people to sense that fragrance and that aroma, whether it just comes through our kindness, body language, our looks, whether it comes from words of encouragement we give, or something God does. So we just hold still for a moment in silence. Sum up all of those situations and the need for the imbuing power and filling of God's Holy Spirit in us tomorrow, that we might be more than just fulfilling a function, performing a role, but we will actually be salt and light, beacons. Don't be shy, just pray out loud. It's okay. I'll do it for us. Loving, living Lord, we thank you, Lord, that your word promises us that we can be fragrance and aroma, perfume, wherever we are. And whilst we may not have thought much about it before, and maybe never practiced it before, never claimed that promise, we ask, Father God, that you will impress upon our minds the rest of this day and tonight and tomorrow how you want us and call us to be fragrance. In all those different activities that have been mentioned, Lord, in those situations, one or two alone, others with two or three or more people in the present, their presence, bring your enabling power and wisdom and words to each of us, that this time tomorrow we will experience, know, see your power working in us and through us. Miraculize our presence tomorrow in the lives of others, we pray. For Jesus' sake, for the growth of the kingdom, for our spiritual growth, we ask, Lord, with thanksgiving and faith. Amen.